As an introduction, much has been said regarding the need of ASEAN countries to work together, to co-learn from each other, and to co-create new opportunities together. And the topic of today's conference is what ASEAN wants. What ASEAN wants has also been addressed by the formation of the ASEAN Secretariat to look into ASEAN needs, which includes education. And basically, the ASEAN Secretariat had already had a ASEAN work plan on education from 2016 to 2020. So this is a recent particular agenda. And the 8 sub-goals of the ASEAN work plan on education is number 1, to promote ASEAN awareness, to enhance the quality and access to basic education, especially for the disabled and the marginalized group, to strengthen the use of ICT, perhaps to move towards flexible education, to provide online learning to the students around countries that could not afford to travel to do their postgraduate or their undergraduate in certain countries outside of their countries. Support the development of Tibet and lifelong learning. If Malaysia and other ASEAN countries need to move towards high income, then there is a need for skills to be there, and that's the development of Tibet, to the point that in Malaysia, Tibet is now a premier lane and not just academic lane and not secondary to academic. Complement the efforts of other sectors in the ESD, strengthen higher education sector through quality assurance. Because at the moment now, if you get a degree from Malaysia, it doesn't mean that Thai recognize your degree or Indonesia recognize your degree. So there is a need, therefore, for quality assurance to be done among all the ASEAN countries, so that if you graduate from any of the universities, then it is recognized among the 10 ASEAN countries. Foster the role of higher education in socio-economic development through university-industry partnership. Provide capacity building programs for teachers and communities. So this is some of the issues that the ASEAN work plan is all about. But I would like to concentrate and focus on number 7, which is foster the role of higher education in socio-economic development through university-industry partnership. And if you look into the detail of what the ASEAN Secretariat had planned for this, is to do exactly what Professor Kamarul Azizi was talking about, that if you want to move together into the SDD, there is a need for cross-border education program. And I think when we talk about cross-border, it's not about the university doing things in Malay, it's called short sendiri among the universities, but rather to now have other organizations, WWF, ministries, NGOs, community, industry, all that come together to work on a certain topic, and to increase the industry involvement, because innovation without commercialization will not be able to reach as many people as possible, and therefore there is a need for the industry to also start to come in, the venture caps and all this, all the value chain in moving any of the products across the ASEAN countries, and to enhance, of course, the university-industry collaboration that we need to have. Okay, let me now bring you to the Malaysian case study so that we all understand. Most of the people in the hall are from Malaysia, and there is a need for you to now understand where the country is moving in terms of wanting to move for future research of impact. Encik Razif is here, and he's from EPU, and he can recognize this particular slide, because this comes from RMK 11, yeah, RMK Malaysia's plan, 11th plan, every 5 years to all the delegates from international. Every 5 years the country has decided on the plan, and this is RMK 11, which is on people growth. RMK 10 is on people focus. So we're now shifting from people focus previously to now people growth. It's because we have realized it is not enough to focus on the needs of the people. The question is, what is the outcome and what is the impact that you get out of doing that? So there is therefore the requirement for the lecturers in the room, please to take note that the expectation of universities in RMK 11 is only 2. Among all the mega pages of the RMK 11 expectation from university is only two: to translate innovation to wealth. Only two, but big job, big responsibility. All right. And to translate innovation to wealth can be done two ways. One is enterprise innovation, and the other is social innovation. In terms of enterprise innovation, the universities are asked to basically enhance demand-driven research. Demand-driven research meaning what is it that the industry want, and therefore what is it that we can do to help consolidate the industry or create new industries. So that's demand-driven. The other one is social innovation. This is more difficult to do. This is social innovation, strengthening collaboration through a whole society approach. And this is what I want to get at, right? Because all this while, the university, usually we do not undergo whole society approach, all right? And as we now go through this, there is a need now to create a social financing model and promote higher order thinking skills in order to develop a dynamic society. Just three lines, very difficult to do, and the question is, what is the way to go forward? And therefore, at the ministry, I can safely say, because as DG before, this is how the Ministry of Higher Education plan to unlock those two requests of universities in RMK 11. And the way we want to unlock is that the university cannot be only to answer the needs of the industry. I think you can feel the academics all across the various universities will not agree to this. That we cannot be having our R&D catering for the needs of the industry today, because 20 years from now, this particular industry may no longer exist. Then what do you do with the graduates that come out from this particular industry that we have trained? And they will be blasé by that time. So bottom line is that the university cannot be just answering to the needs of the industry. The university also needs to answer to the needs of the government, the needs of academia itself to generate knowledge, and of course the needs of the community. So at the end of the day, despite whatever anybody says, the university has to answer to the quadruple helix. All right. Although in EPU's mindset, KPI from the university is commercialization of R&D, commercialization of R&D. That is rather, I would say, I can now safely say, because as Vice Chancellor I can say, but as a DG before I couldn't, that this is rather myopic, because the university can do a lot more things than just commercialization of R&D. So therefore, the university is here to help the industry, but also to help the community, to help the government, and to also generate knowledge. So this is now, therefore, the quadruple helix. Yeah? And therefore, how do we now make sure that this happens? And so at the ministry before, these are the new types of research proposal, research grants that is backed in order to have these things being done. And basically, to do one, which is researcher-driven, which is what we always do. But researcher-driven is not bad. There is a need to generate knowledge. And from this is where we train all the PhDs, the masters, and so on and so forth, talent development that is needed by the country. But along the way, when we start to do this, this is how we start new industries, how we create blue sky industries, things that is why fundamental grants is still important in order to drive apply to the next level. And this is where we also generate IPR. And if we do generate IPR, this is where commercialization of R&D can now take place. All right? In terms of enterprise innovation, this is demand-driven research. And when it's demand-driven, the industry can come from, it can come from industry, it can come from the business sector, it can also come from the service sector that is now asking the help of the of the university to do this. But whatever it is, it will definitely strengthen our industry-academia relationship. And we have grants called PPRM, Public-Private Research Network grants, that is now available to move this particular issue. Then, the more important and more difficult to do, this is social innovation, where it strengthens the broader approach or the whole society approach. That in itself inculcates the values-driven part of the grant. That is where mostly SGD goals will now be able to be strengthened. Yeah. So this is the way, and the MOHE's roadmap for value chain pathway is basically now to move from foundation to enhancing performance to delivering excellence to move to people growth, so that we achieve that 3R: respected, referred, and relevant, and move the university from high tech to high touch. You understand this? High technology, but at the end of the day, how do we make it accessible, affordable, available to those who need it most? And when we manage to do that, that will be high touch, right? So you may say, this is what we have been doing. And along the way, we have managed to move 5 research universities into the top 1% universities in the world, including USM, all right? But despite that, the OECD report on R&D in Malaysia still states that Malaysian R&D need to show impact. And I can imagine how much hair pulling Professor Raha, who is in JPT, in charge of R&D, is now having, because here we are doing publications, moving up in the rankings, and still OECD says that Malaysian R&D need to show impact. Okay? The question is, RDC, research, development, commercialization, that has been the value chain. Ain't nothing wrong with that. The question is, how do we approach the RDC value chain? That matters. And that is why the ministry says, okay, we need to move all 4. Talent, research, bridging the grand challenge, wealth creation, we need to move all 4 in at the same time, okay? Because whatever that we've been doing in the RDC value chain, we do research, and then we get grants for applied to do development of the prototype. And then when we finish with the innovation, we go to the community and we test whether the community likes our innovation. And so we use the community to get data, and then we come back with the community's evaluation, and we say, you know, we take a selfie and we say like this, everything is okay, community likes what we do, okay? QED, that means we solve all the problem. But you come back to that community 10 years from now, and you find that that innovation is not being used. Therefore, we fail to assimilate that innovation into the community. And when that happens, there is no impact, there is no outcome of the result that we've been talking about, because we fail to create sustainable change in the community. We fail to change the lifestyle of the people. We fail to change the socio-economic well-being of the community. That's the bottom line, and that is why Malaysian R&D have got to improve from just doing what we've been doing today. And therefore, I quote what Einstein says, it is insane to continue to do the same thing over and over again and expect to get different results. Because that's what we're doing, RDC value chain, right? And we expect to get different results. We're not gonna get different results because OECD will continue to say we didn't create an impact. And because we cannot solve our problems with the same thinking we use when we created them. So there is a need now to undergo new thinking in R&D. And this is what I have to say. Instead of using the word knowledge transfer, KTP, knowledge transfer, perhaps we should go now to knowledge exchange. Because when you say knowledge transfer, it's about you creating something good for the community, and you tell the community, this is the best thing since sliced bread, and why are you not using this innovation? It's about you telling the community, you did not sit down and listen to what is it that the community wants. There is a need also that when you work together with the community, there's a lot of knowledge exchange, there's a lot that you can now learn from the community as well, and we fail to do that. So therefore, we need to now move from knowledge transfer to knowledge exchange. And I've said in the recent launching of the KTP community engagement, KTP is a brand, perhaps it should be knowledge transformation rather than knowledge transfer. Program, yeah, knowledge transformation, how we transform the entire community with the knowledge that we have. Because at the end of the day, it's very important that we undergo community engagement to give the fishing rod to the people and not the fish. Do you understand? You don't bring in rice, gula, everything to the community and then say, here, I'm helping the community. That is welfare. This is a university, we are not a welfare service. We should be teaching the people how to use the fishing rod so that they can fish, so that when we leave the community, it is sustainable. Right? So that is something that I want the students also to understand, because this Bhakti Siswa thingy has been going on over and over again and still expect to get different results. It's not going to happen. Alright? So that's why the other one is knowledge impact to now knowledge assimilation. Because I say at the end of the day, it's about outcome. It's no longer about impact, it's about outcome. And this is why there is a need now to change the paradigm shift of how we do RDC to whole society approach. And as a result of that, we will now, end game is to get prominent researchers undertaking impactful research, not just age index galore. Age index, very high age index, most cited, etc., etc., very good, but it is only for you. What did society benefit from that high age index that you have forgot, that you have gotten? That is the question I will also ask from the researchers with the high age index. What have you done with the knowledge that you have created? Okay, so that is moving now towards wisdom. So the next one is to have institution-based consortium working together. Now, no longer in silo, the melting of the disciplines, arts, science, medicine, all working together. Now, in research innovation to enhance inclusivity, and finally, at the end of the day, to end game, to have globally recognized niche areas. So, in Mohe, we have done all that basically to move now from not KPI that's given by Pemandu, that's given by EPU and everybody else, all right, knowledge generation, income generation, publication, etc., etc., but move that now together in a quadruple helix mode to now create a balance between KPI, key performance indicator, and KIP, key intangible performance. That means what kind of impact values have you now created with the work that you have done. Okay, easier said than done, how can we achieve this? And this is why I want to bring you down to USM and what USM is now doing in order to try to move this particular agenda. This is the whole society approach, or what we call Nexus at USM. Okay, let me start by saying, in a world made up of 7.6 billion, 2.6 billion are rich, and the World Bank estimates that 1.47 billion, or one-fifth of the population, live in extreme poverty, earning less than $1.25 a day. These are called the bottom billion. So a developing country cannot ignore these marginalized people, because the poor, ladies and gentlemen, is the largest human resource in the developing country. And whether we like it or not, overcoming poverty remains the single most important challenge for us all. I think we are all familiar with this particular line. But in SDG, what we want to be able to do now, to interpret that and say, now how do we help to reduce inequity? Yeah, to mengurangkan jurang perbezaan antara miskin dan kaya. How do we help to reduce inequity? How do we make things now available for the first time? How do we make things affordable? Because if it is available, but it is not affordable, it is also useless, because people cannot get access to that. So if it is available, it is affordable, but it's not accessible, it's also useless. You understand? You want to create something to diagnose for typhoid. Yes, it is available. It is affordable. We make sure that it is affordable. But you have to use electricity in order to make that diagnosis. But in my village, I have no electricity. You understand? So therefore, the solution provided is not complete. Do you understand? It is not complete because you are not making it accessible. And the last part, you did not make it appropriate for the people, for the target audience. So therefore, the thinking in the mindset of R&D work from Z to A. That means end in mind, the target, who is the target to receive whatever innovation you want to do, then at the end of the day, then go back to the laboratory. Otherwise, if you work from A to Z, the way your lecturers have been training you, you will now not be achieving this impactful research. You'll be doing the same thing over and over again and expect to get different results, which Einstein says it is insane. Okay? Therefore, what should we work on? This is a concept that I learned from Ahmad Zuel, who just died this year. That means that there are no more Muslim Nobel laureate alive in science. One was Darussalam, the other one is Ahmad Zuel. So now there's a need now to try to find another Muslim Nobel laureate in the world. Okay. Ahmad Zuel is a Nobel laureate in chemistry, and he was a consultant to Malaysia in science and technology. So in a close room discussion with Academy Science members, of which I'm a member, he said this: if we work on research topics that the West is not interested in, we will always be 20 years ahead. But if we work on topics that the West is interested in, we will be 20 years behind. Do you understand this? Because we cannot compete with the Rockefeller lab, with the Harvard lab, with the Stanford lab, right? One phone call, all reagents will come in the afternoon. In Malaysia, one phone call, nothing happens. Maybe 2-3 months, you get your reagents. If you want to buy equipment, maybe 1 year, you still cannot get the equipment. Am I right? So bottom line, how can we compete with the Rockefellers, the Stanfords and the Harvards, right? So why can't we work smart? And this is what he is saying. If you work on something that the West is not interested in, that is the problem of the poor. The West is not interested in problem of the poor because they feel that the poor cannot pay. And if the poor cannot pay, why do we now create something for the poor? Is that crystal to you? Right? So, but we have to do something about this, because that's what I would like to share with you. Because this, ladies and gentlemen, is blue ocean. You can talk to the cows come home about blue ocean, but blue ocean is looking at you in the face and we do not know it. Okay? What is blue ocean? Ask Mr. Google now, if you don't know it, to boldly go where no one has gone before. If you have seen Star Trek, this is what Gene Roddenberry will always say, you know, to boldly go where no man has gone before, because I refuse to do this. This is SGD. We have to be gender balanced and gender sensitive. And please never call me chairman again. I am chairperson, all right? So that is one thing you need to be aware of when your vice chancellor is a woman. Make sure you use the right words. The thing is, this is blue ocean, and what I'm trying to say is the same thing I've been saying over and over again. Stop playing catching up and turn around the way we do research in this country. All right? Why can't we turn around and address the needs of the 1.47 billion people on the planet that is now living below poverty line, including those living below poverty line in Malaysia? Concentrate on research outcomes and technology development that will reduce inequity and enhance accessibility for those who need it most. Why? Because we have no competitor. This is blue ocean. We have no competitor. Because if you work on diseases of the poor like typhoid, there is no competitor. That's why I work on typhoid. From creating something new that is not there before. And that is what novelty and patents, intellectual property is all about. And if we now work on something that is blue ocean, that is a gold mine where we have no competitor, everything you do is publishable. And that's how you get all the papers published. And if this is the first time you're doing it and you start to publish it, many people will quote it, and as a result, this is how you get high citation index. You see what I'm trying to say? There's a lot of things that you can gain by working to help the bottom billion. And while you're doing this, all right, you will now have to undergo real-world experience via community engagement, because you cannot solve the solution, provide the solution, unless you see what is it that the community wants. And therefore, you have to undergo community engagement to provide solution and know-how that will ensure sustainability of change. And this then promotes action-oriented research, because this is what we want in the future. And the experience will provide a better understanding and make the university, the solution, more relevant to the people and the needs of the community. Then and only then do we now provide local solutions in niche areas, and these local solutions answer global problems, and only then can we see the balance between impact and impact factor. You understand? Impact factor is about publishing in journals, in ISI journals, but if we start to do this, we get the impact to the community and balance that with impact factor and nurture prominent yet impactful research leaders who are able to provide sustainable solutions for humanity to use. But those in this field, let us be realistic. Despite the political will, it is not easy to preach the grand challenge that means to bring your innovation into society. We need to convince the researcher to provide solutions that can create sustainable change. And if you want to involve the industry, the solution involved must be commercially viable. And the question is, can we now, instead of just making profit, can we balance profit with sustainability? This is what the challenge from EPU is, to come up with a new financial model to do this. And the solution must also be accepted by the government and culturally acceptable to the community. Because if you want long-term change, the government, the NGO, the DOs, all have got to come in and provide this. So providing solution to the bottom billion is a long journey, but if we don't start, who will start? And to USM, this is the APEX agenda. And this, again, is the paradigm shift of whole society approach. All this has to happen at the same time. So if I had an animation, I would say all this is now turning at the same time. That means you have to work in a consortium, you have to foster university-led growth, translate the R&D to business value, brand and position the R&D for global prominence. Okay, this is a cycle, but in relation, this I want to show you in action so that you can understand what this is all about. Because if you don't see an example, you won't understand. This is Cerebral Palsy Research Cluster, one of the nexus that is now done by Professor Nick Soriani in Kebangkrian, Kelantan, our medical campus. You understand cerebral palsy? This is the student, the children of cerebral palsy. Essentially, in this family, all seven children have cerebral palsy. So you can imagine, if you have one child, it's difficult to take care of. Imagine this mother having to take care of seven children, all with cerebral palsy. And cerebral palsy basically is permanent disorder of the development of the movement and posture, attributed to non-progressive disturbance in developing in the fetal or infant brain, often accompanied by disturbance in sensation, perception, cognition, etc., etc. All this, there's no need for you to understand, but enough for you to know that there are many things we don't know about cerebral palsy. But what we know is that the types, there are four types, we don't even know what kind of genetic disorder that is now happening that create these people to become cerebral palsy. But all we know is that it is very prevalent among the more deprived, the more miskin you are, the more chance that you have cerebral palsy in the family. Okay? And therefore, this research will provide evidence-based data, because there is no data in Malaysia regarding the number of cases for cerebral palsy, and therefore, if we start to do this, you can imagine if the data is not there, because many people are not reporting. Many people would like to keep this under the carpet, because it's not very nice to be able to share with everybody, you know, you have a child that has cerebral palsy. So bottom line, they are usually kept further and further, and you can see how thin they are, and you can see, yeah, the legs are very thin, they can't move. If this is the challenge for R&D, I challenge therefore people in nutrition, if they can make the fish become bigger and faster with the better fish meal, Can they now think about providing a better nutrition so that at least now these children can become almost a better human beings? Question is, this is what is lacking in the country. We have no data regarding how many cerebral palsy cases there are. We have no way of screening, diagnosis and clinical intervention. The children have no accessibility from their home to come to the NGO or the Ministry of Welfare. They are providing the services to help the rehabilitation service, but the mother need to bring the child from the home to the hospital because the mother cannot leave. Because if she now goes and bring the child, she cannot work. And when she cannot work, she cannot make the money and she cannot feed the child. Do you understand? It is a vicious cycle. Therefore, the children stays home. And you have the service here and you have the child there and there is no gap. Nobody is filling the gap of how to bring, no, R&D is not there. How to bring the child to the hospital or how to make now the bring the service to the child. I mean, that's R&D. You can start to do this. You can start to fill the gap when people start to think together. And sustainable support system for home-based rehab, nutrition, normalization. Do you want this child to be like this all the time? Or do you want to make that challenge of R&D to ensure the child is standing up and to normalize the child in society again? And then the caregivers, also knowledge was not given to them, because you don't know who has cerebral palsy children, how are you going to tell the caregiver what to do? If the caregiver have access to internet, then the caregiver is not coming from the poor, is it? Because as I said, only the poor have children with cerebral palsy, majority. So therefore they don't have access to information. So this is the challenge now for R&D. How now do we provide knowledge to the caregivers, community awareness and education, and inter-agency collaboration? Again, this particular topic comes in whole society approach, and this is what is done. In whole society approach, Nick Sorani and team had everybody work together from T0. The community is not a data provider. The community is the collaborator. The NGO are not the data provider. The NGO is the collaborator. The industry is the collaborator. The ministry is the collaborator. Everybody is the collaborator in the beginning of the research. So that now everybody is involved to provide the buy-in in order now to have this thing, to find the cerebral palsy cases. Community goes out to find this. Alright, they find their report and then they start to do this. And we have JKM Malaysia, you have international parties who can now be working on statistics of cerebral palsy itself. We have the London School doing that, and a lot of other agencies, international agencies coming in, industries coming in, everything is coming in. We have music therapy. I can't go through this in detail, but essentially all this is done with community engagement for knowledge assimilation. In the whole society approach, what we say is that the university, the ministry, the NGO, the community, they are all collaborators. They are not people in the value chain that you just say, okay, I have this, can you start to do this? And not, it's not like that. So from the beginning, they are involved from the beginning. The design of the innovations are with the involvement in the industry so that you get the technology and you get now the ability to commercialize and be able to use it in others. Services to be provided are in collaboration with the service sector. That means if the ministry that is providing the rehabilitation service is in the hospital, whatever, they are all working together. The R&D, can you imagine the molecular genetics behind this disease, which is basically a gold mine? There's no one doing this. The diagnostics, the genetics itself to find the genes involved, all this is not known. So anybody working on this is a gold mine, because there are so many areas that is blue ocean. You're going to get high output for publication and also for IPR. This is totally values driven, so that you can now be able to see the research can also, instead of just government grant, because this is now values driven, you can get the money from CSR, from CIMB or whatever company that is interested to do this, from the industry, you can create endowment, you can also have wakaf fund to now be able to help these people, which is now alternative to government grant, not just being very dependent on government grant to do the research. And bottom line, it is providing local solution to solve now global problems. and what is the expected outcome, so that we can now create a better CP policy, cerebral palsy policy, establish the CP registry for Malaysia at least, and if we are successful, we can do this for the other ASEAN countries, establish integrated healthcare service. Integration is the word, the key challenge of the R&D. Can you normalize these people back to society? That would be the key challenge. And as you can see, there are many famous persons with cerebral palsy. The challenge is from flat to now moving up and now be able to move. You have this Jamak Kimere, which is the award-winning writer, Gary Jewel, which is the award-winning actress, all that. It opens up a new industry on disability. That, ladies and gentlemen, is Blue Ocean. And bottom line, you remember our own local hero, Muhammad Rizwan Muhammad Uzi, right? That is the created history to win Malaysia's first gold medal in the 2016 Paralympic Games. And he has been diagnosed with cerebral palsy since he was 1 year old. Bottom line, this is a kid with cerebral palsy. We have changed from this flat, yeah, to now someone who is in the hearts of the nation. We can bring him to normalization. But the question is Muhammad Rizwan Muhammad Uzi by chance? Why should he only this child like this by chance? Why can't we do this by design? And if we can create this, this is the kind of impact and outcome that we would like to have. Because whatever I've said just now, this is a journey, not a destination. More still needs to be done, but the whole society approach may be our answer to show impactful results. So with that, I thank you very much for your time. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.